And now, it is my great pleasure to introduce the brand new Galaxy S20.
While Samsung is well known for its mainstream handsets such as the Galaxy S series, they have experimented with more radical, risky and interesting designs over the years. Take the Galaxy K Zoom for instance, a phone digital camera hybrid that attempted to combine the convenience of a phone and the zoom lens from a point and shoot. Then there was the arch-backed Galaxy Round, which promised better ergonomics. The Active series, which fused flagship features with a rugged military-like design. And very recently the foldable Z Flip and the Galaxy Fold, touted to be the form smartphones will adopt in the future. However, a current mainstay in the premium Android market was also once considered to be unusual and unnecessary. When the original Samsung Galaxy Note was released in 2011, every critic had the same complaint. It was just too big for a smartphone. Some considered it silly to use and hold a gigantic rectangle to your ear while on a call. That sentiment seems absurd now, but keep in mind most smartphones back then, such as the iPhone 4S, Nokia N9, or Samsung's own Galaxy S2, weren't that huge. Even the largest ones didn't cross the 5-inch mark. The other problem was the existence of its more compact flagship cousin, the Galaxy S2. The S2 had the same processor and was easier on the wallet and the pocket. However, there were two main advantages with the Note: the higher screen resolution and the added functionality of the S Pen. The general public took notice of that, and this warranted a successor. The Note 2 was a significant upgrade in many ways. It had a more powerful quad-core processor as opposed to the dual-core in its predecessor. The RAM, the display size, and the capacity of the battery all increased significantly, but it also received similar praises and criticisms. Reviewers liked its speed, display quality, and battery life, while they were still not too fond of its unwieldy size and its expensive price tag. Regardless, this was a success too. That brings us to the Note 3. The Note and the Note 2 got their design cues from the S2 and S3 respectively. However, the Note 3 resorted to a more angular design when compared to the S4. Its all plastic build does not look as premium as current devices or even its competitors sold back then, such as the HTC One with its aluminium frame or the elegant all glass Sony Xperia Z1. Regardless, it is well put together and you don't need to worry about cracking the back of the device. And this has held up structurally over the 7 or so years, excluding the chipping of the paint on the sides. It has all the usual ports and buttons of a 2013 Android device, but the one that stands out is the micro USB 3.0 port, which promised faster data transfer rates and charging compared to the micro USB 2.0. As far as I can remember, this port was not too common on Android phones, and conveniently it was backward compatible with micro USB 2.0. It was the standard for Android back then. There's a removable 4 leather back panel that can be used to replace the 3200mAh battery, which in its original state could have easily provided a day's worth of usage, if it wasn't as old as the phone itself. The removable back cover added the possibility of customization. Samsung sold an identical back cover that added wireless charging and was compatible with any Qi charging pad. If this blush pink version wasn't your cup of tea, there were other colors available such as the standard black and white, and the more limited options like rose gold white, rose gold black, and merlot red. Speaking of colors, the Note 3's vibrant 1080p Super AMOLED display is a significant upgrade from its predecessor's 720p screen. Even to this day, it is big, bright, and beautiful with a pixel density close to the more modern Note 10 Lite, though color accuracy would have improved over the years. The downward facing speaker is quite tinny and flat, which would have been inferior to the HTC One that produced richer sound. While the sizes of earlier Notes were a bit out of place, larger phones were normalized by the time the Note 3 hit the stores. Samsung had phones like the Galaxy Mega with its 6.3-inch screen. LG's G2 and G Flex had 5.2 inches and 6 inches displays respectively. The Sony Xperia Z Ultra had a 6.4-inch screen. Even Apple, which seemed rigid with the tiny form factor, released the 5.5-inch iPhone 6 Plus the following year. The Note series showed that there was a market for larger phones, and thus change the smartphone landscape. The Note 3 had the Qualcomm Snapdragon 800 processor, which was also used on competitive flagships such as the LG G2, Nexus 5, Nokia Lumia 1520, and Sony Xperia Z1. While the N9005 model, such as the one I'm holding, came with the Snapdragon chipset, an octa-core Exynos variant also exists. According to benchmarks like this one produced by TechSpot, while the Snapdragon version had a marginal edge over the Exynos one, the performance was quite similar overall. If you were aware of Samsung's releases in the early 2010s, the Note 3 was a familiar design that was noticeably Samsung. Every Samsung device, regardless of the price, looked pretty much the same: a physical home button placed in between two capacitive keys. This design was finally abandoned 4 years later in favor of on-screen keys in the S8, although some budget phones still retained the classic layout until a couple of years ago. This phone was launched with Android 4.3, also known as Jelly Bean, with the final upgrade being Android 5, which incorporated the material design, giving the TouchWiz skin a cleaner look. Gestures are a big part of the user experience. Air gestures use sensors that recognized hand movements and did not require the user to touch the screen. It was applicable for certain operations such as swiping through pictures in the gallery, showing a glance of the time and date, and answering calls. Most of these gestures don't feel very intuitive to me, but they do work most of the time. There are also other gestures for zooming, panning, and muting alarms and calls. This also had a lot of built-in functionality that was ahead of its time, such as the ability to have multiple windows on the screen and one-handed operation for smaller hands. While updates for this device have concluded a while ago, custom ROMs are still being created to this day to keep the Note 3 up to date. Along with its plethora of features came bloatware, out of which there were a few useful applications that were well suited for the Note. Apart from S-Note being the go-to app for jotting down notes or doodling during your free time, Sketchbook gives more freedom in terms of brushes, resolution of the canvas, and the choice to have multiple layers. I'm no artist, but I've seen many who've made good use of this app. Kids Mode is something that is still available in modern Samsung handsets, which is an app suitable for a restless toddler. It changes the UI of the phone to a limited set of activities such as coloring, drawing, and playing music. It works as a child lock too, since it prevents the kid from exiting the app and requires a pin to get out of the interface. You can monitor your child's playtime and their frequently used applications as well. The 7-year-old S Pen is not as state-of-the-art or responsive as the current offerings, but it was quite advanced for the time. It inherited some of the features from the Note 2, such as hovering the pen over to preview an item, taking screenshots and writing over them, and the 1024 levels of pressure sensitivity. There were some simple yet effective upgrades, such as making the pen symmetrical such that you don't have to fuss about how it should be inserted in the slot, and the popping up of the Air command menu whenever you remove the stylus. The S Pen has witnessed many improvements over the years, some drastic, others incremental. The Note 4 Pen doubled in terms of pressure sensitivity. The Note 5 removed much of the bloat and added a button to easily remove the pen. The Note 7 again doubled the pressure sensitivity to 4096 levels, though it unfortunately had other claims to fame. The pen on the Note 9 could be used as a remote for taking pictures, moving through the slides of a presentation, and many other functions. An SDK was also launched for third-party applications to further utilize it. Finally, the Note 10 added air gestures with the inclusion of a gyroscope in the pen. Another area where Notes have improved annually is the camera. This one borrows its components from the Galaxy S4, which means that it has a 13-megapixel camera, single LED flash, and an aperture of f2.2. We take quick snaps for granted nowadays that we have forgotten that the Note 3 shows a progress bar after every picture. Modes and filters are just a swipe away, and you can download more filters if required. Of course, the picture quality does not hold a candle to the latest devices, but I would say that the end result is very respectable. It is a testament of how far we have come in terms of dynamic range, sharpness, and low light performance. With 4K recording first being introduced on the Acer Liquid S2, it made its way onto the Note 3, which was only available on the Qualcomm variants. It has the ability to shoot at 30 frames per second with a duration limit of 5 minutes, and since 4K recording was a very early feature in smartphones, It has no video stabilization at this resolution. Considering its age, the Note 3 handles the latest applications quite well, starting with social media apps such as Twitter, Instagram, and Reddit. Despite facing occasional lags and slowdowns, it is quite usable. All in all, this handles basic day-to-day operations decently. But how about more intensive tasks? How well do the Snapdragon 800 and Adreno 330 work in 2021? Even though this is compatible with many graphics-intensive games, it is unable to proceed past the loading screen in most situations. The phone does get quite warm and it tends to just turn off out of the blue. Unless you're an avid gamer, the Note 3 is manageable for day-to-day usage in 2021, while you will lose out on compatibility pretty soon. The Note to this day has remained a reliable but pricey mainstay in the flagship smartphone space. Samsung has shifted its priority from function to form, and maybe because of that, it does not stand out as much as it used to. However, its one unique selling point, the S Pen, has been successful, being ported over to Samsung's tablets and laptops. As of producing this video, the future seems murky for the Note series. There have been rumors of discontinuation of this lineup floating around, and the sales for the cheaper Note 20 have been below expectations. The Android flagship space is more competitive than ever. We see companies such as Xiaomi, Huawei, OnePlus, and Vivo bring their products at much cheaper rates. You still can't go wrong with a Note, but the price tag just does not seem as warranted as it used to be. It was interesting to just revisit a now 8-year-old device and look back at what we expected and enjoyed from flagships not too long ago in the early 2010s. Let me know your experiences in the comments if you own the Note 3, and be sure to like and subscribe. Thank you for watching.